bonus content from some external sources, so we do have 8.
I bet we do. I bet we do, Almond.
As I can see. Welcome to CW3.
Hello and welcome to Two Dogs and the Truth, the Cockney Watchdogs long overdue Cockney Watchdogs cast, aka this record is Cockney Watchdogs 3, name unknown, GRR hashtag 009, released March the 3rd, the year 2000, almost 25 years ago.
Interesting, which means 1, 2 and 3 were all released within the same year. Which is accurate.
Yes. I went to the United States in 1999, and between me going in 1999 and going back in 2000, I believe we recorded
4 albums.
One. And this was recorded after my first time in the States. Yeah, but before the second time, I think, around that time, which is why we'll get to this soon. There's quite a Japanese influence on this album because I was about to go to Japan. That was what was on the horizon.
Yes, influence is a choiced word.
No,
I'm going to point out what I pointed out when we weren't recording, which is it says Cockney Watchdos on the album cover, and it is bold to get your band's name wrong on the title of an album.
It's a cool cover, though. We're in some sort of hall of mirrors, and it's just you and me, and we've got kind of like fuzzy faces, and it's a pretty cool cover, actually.
Yes, I like the cover. I think the cover is a testament to great CW art.
Oh, yeah. And actually, word art. See, word art.
Yes. So circling it all round to March the 3rd, 2000, keeping everything in the right lane,
exactly.
As you will.
So it seems like this 2 and 3 were recorded on the same tape, and when they were digimond, all the songs kind of got mixed up. So as you pointed out in the last episode with CW2, there's clearly some things that should have been on CW3, and very much so in here, there's clearly some stuff that should have been on CW2, not least of all the second track, Hello, which talks about how it's the beginning of CW2. It's not even the beginning of CW3, but such is the Watchdogs. The reason why this is classed as 009B in my rankings is because I believe I combined A and B into kind of a double album. So if these were ever going to be commercially available, they'd be on the same CD. I believe.
Two and three are definitely the biggest package deal of the CW albums.
Oh yeah, between them there's like 60 songs or something like that. Yeah. So I have to say this album is, and I don't know how I would have chosen the songs when I was doing them. They're in these ones are not in alphabetical order.
No, which confused me even more. I think that I had more influence on this one. I think you can tell from the
maybe. But I'll have to pause you there while I go to the bathroom. Or Blood Mind Cop. You feel that your influence was stronger in this record. Is this what you're saying?
I would say that. It seems like a lot of these songs now are ideas that I have had. I think clues to that are a lot of the same song repeated.
Oh, we'll go through them because...
A lot of the same concepts repeated.
It's hard to... It was hard for me when I was going through to be like, is this a cover of one we've already done before, or am I just remembering it for the first time? So let's jump into one that definitely is a version of a song we heard on CW2. This one is called Cockneys Evolve into Rookies.
Cockneys evolve in training to rookie. Cockney evolve.
Cockney evolve.
Cockney evolve. Cockney evolve. Nina, the rookie stage. Cockney evolve
indeed. What do you make of that one?
It's a very mellow start to the album. It's an odd choice as the first song. I would say it's not
single.
Yes, considering they're not in alphabetical order. It's quite a mellow one for this album. I don't mind it. I don't like the noises that get made. I'm not a fan of them. And I must have just had like
you mean
a month.
the growling?
Yes, I'm not a fan of all the growls. I don't like them. I must have just had a Digimon phase for like a month because it's specifically aimed around the idea of Digimon evolving and then being able to evolve backwards as well.
Because the other song is Cockneys evolve into rookies evolve into Cockneys, right? On CW2.
I believe it's rookies evolve. There's like rookies and champions and all kinds of stuff. There's a few though, but this one doesn't have the "we are quite" sample over it like the other ones, where it says "we are quite stupid, we are quite clever, etc."
Oh yeah.
So it stands out on its own from the package that it comes in.
It's so not even on.
Champions
to rookies, champions to rookies, Cranky and this bird. One is Cockneys evolve into rookies. So a theme. I've said Cockney evolve a gentle, mature CW sound. There's a slow sample and some gentle growling. Mina gets a shout out, and there's a bit of a Joy Division vibe for me.
Sure is.
A Cockney vote to end the rookie stage, advertising the rookies to champion songs. Hand claps and growling.
Yeah, Cockney Evolve is a play on Digivolve.
Okay.
But without really trying. I think I noticed Mina getting a shout out as well, but I think we all do. They also say something about Anne evolving into Anna.
Yeah, so that's right.
I think there's a few mentions knocked in, but I picked up on the Mina one first as well, which led me to question, was she a Digimon in the Cockney Watchdogs universe?
Possibly, but she's also... She's also there on a few songs. She pops up and sings on a few songs, and she's clearly in the room for some others where she's kind of just watching.
Yes, interesting. These are some cameos I'd forgotten about.
Yeah.
Yeah, every time she was just there, she could have provided the growls for this. I don't think she did, though.
No, I don't think so. So we're moving on now to Hello, which is the second song. There's not many songs in this album that refer to other albums. So when we were doing it early on, there was quite like almost every song was referring to another song or had a sample of something. So this one's got very few, but this is one of the ones that refers directly to a pretty obscure song that you won't know, but I'll play you a bit later. But first, let's listen to Hello, not the Lionel Richie song.
Adele.
Hello.
So when you sing Hello for Mr. John Doe, you're referring to this song, and you definitely did not know it at the time.
Oh, is it?
So this is a bold move for a pop video. It not only took the simple sing-along, but it also put everyone nude in the video as well. So this is one that me and when I went to my friend's house, they had like German cable. This would always come on, like in the evenings. Like there'd be some saucy videos, and this was always on. Hello, hello, a phone call from a certain Mr. John Doe, and I sang it a few times in this song, and you copied me. So
I see.
Are you familiar with that song, Twinkle?
I am not. I am unfamiliar. I'm surprised it made it onto YouTube, though.
It's a Euro pop anthem.
I did say it's referenced incorrectly as Tape Crew throughout the song. This is what I mean. This is what I mean when I say I had more of an influence on this one. And there's less lyrics, there's less structure, and there's less vocals. It's a lot more just pressing the demo button on a keyboard.
It's several demos playing over the top of one another, which, unless we had several keyboards, we must have done it on the four track. Because sometimes we recorded it just straight to tape, like we pressed, like record, but others are in the four tracks, so there's multiple, and then some of them even use the Doctor sample to sample things. Whereas that little we talked about today, SK10, I think, is the Casio keyboard that has like a 1 second sample function. That's what we were using.
Yes, I very much enjoyed that sample function. I utilized that a lot.
We all did.
Yeah, I did make the note. Did you tell me who John Doe was, or did I already know about how they named anonymous corpses?
No, I think you just copied me singing Hello, Hello, a phone call for a certain Mr. Doe, John Doe. And then you introduced it to, well, hello, welcome everyone to the second tape. Yes. Cockney Chaos opening, tape two of the Cockney Watchdogs, Nathan proclaims as we enter tape three. He is doing the robot voice. Let's get some jazz, he shouts as the bark keyboard demo plays. Let's get some quiet. MCU Zaz are the wheels of steel. Demo-tastic Zaz ad-libs. He says, let's get some trumpets, and then the demo plays trumpet sounds. Let's get some double trummy with it. Bongos may be introduced. There is also an underlying sense of anger at times with Zaz in this song.
I agree. There seems to be a sort of a man, like, I feel like I've really taken over with this one. This is the one where I said it was 2 minutes too long. I also said it could be our laziest song to date, as it is just the demo of a keyboard and me occasionally saying the word hello. At least in the other Hello songs, there was instruments being played.
There's some bongos pop up at the end, maybe some xylophones, but I do think the layering of the demos keeps it interesting. So it's very chaotic. The beautiful demos will come through.
Yes, and compared to what is coming, it is Bohemian Rhapsody.
In many ways, it's a music concrete or a
exactly.
Plunder phonics. Are you familiar with the concept of plunder phonics?
No, yeah. I am not. But maybe I am unknowingly.
What about what's coming up next? Are we ready to move on? Is what everyone wants to hear.
Yes, my last point was there was no jazz.
There wasn't really any jazz, but some of the demos were a bit jazzy, so that might have been what you're referring to.
Yes, I'd like to say that.
So this one is called Japanese Talking. Now, just listen, everyone. Just have a listen before you make any judgment, and then we will talk about it afterwards. So no complaints until you've listened to what we have to say. So that gem was called Japanese Talking. It is the first of four, I believe, songs on this album that consist of them doing the voice very much so for a long time.
For minutes on end.
Anything to say about this?
I stand by it. I remember you having magnets with Japanese.
Yeah, it's a book, and one page of the book you tore it off, and it had magnets that you could, or stickers that you could put on items around the house to tell you what they were in Japanese, to learn Japanese.
I believe we had. Did you also have magnets? I just remember like a bag of magnets.
It's possible. I don't remember, but I think you're reading from a book, maybe, because you say Zubon several times, which is pants, and at one point you say Kutsushita, which is socks. You say that several times. So there's discernible, and you actually say Kutsushita pretty well. There's discernible language within these hijinks, but you're just playing around with it. It's not, it's done out of love. It's not done out of disrespect for the Japanese language.
Yes, no, it's. I think it's only heightened by Hannah having a cold and having like a really off croaky voice that makes her sound like she's doing a character. And she has a lot of energy in this one, a lot of emotion coming through in what she's in these sort of Japanese talking parts.
Hijinks is how I would describe it.
Yes, but I think we are looking at single words and just saying them out loud.
Oh, yeah. Anna is doing the voice. Zaz is having a go. He sounds like pigs and birds. It makes perfect sense. It sounds like they have access to a text, but they're only loosely using it. There is some crying at some point. And throughout, I've written Sweet Sweet Keyboard Improvisations, but that's not true. That's from the later version. This one is purely a cappella Japanese talking. At least you use the whole word.
Exactly. Yes, to, I'm not going to use the word. I can't remember what I was going to say. To defend us, we were children.
We're children let loose with a Japanese textbook. What else were we going to do? And a tape recorder.
And the need to record it four times.
It was the year 2000, after all. Y2K, why not K?
Times were different.
Anyway, we'll come back to it. There's plenty more Japanese talking throughout this album. If anything, it's this backbone of this piece, CW3.
Indeed.
Like I said, it was on the horizon. I was just about to move there, not long, within the year. It's big time.
You can see the influence as well of you not being there in the room.
I'm pretty sure I am there on some of them. One of them, at least, I'm playing some kind of instrument, but not this one. This is just some children going wild. The next one, however, I am definitely there, and this is one of the, possibly the first actual, well, Cockney's Evolve into Rookies is a real song, but it's a sequel. The first actual real song of an album that does not have that many. It probably has about four or five, like, new, brand new tracks. Or have we already done Richard Tucker before?
No, we haven't done Richard Tucker before, I don't think.
All right, let's have a listen to Richard Tucker. From Tararamo in Chiatti with a hat, fashion from Normus, white handkerchief, woman from Prosiga with soft flowing throat and taller bits. Here are last of the tenor that reminded them of Caruso. Richard Tucker. There are a few famous Richard Tuckers out there. I don't know if we are referring to Richard Tucker, the actor. It's unlikely. The lyrics seem to be all about Italian villages and hills and things, which is, I think, was a staple at this point of us simply reading a page from something. This sounds like an in-flight magazine.
Yes, a very early CW trait.
That's Mina in the middle, right? That was me
towards the end. Yeah, I didn't clock that. I didn't know she was in this one as well. That's a nice treat. I speculate that Richard Tucker was the name of the man who wrote this book about Italian villages. Is what I would speculate. I only made two notes about this song. The first one was I like the looped Richard Tucker in the Cockney voice, and then my next note was that actually it was quite thin quite quickly.
Yeah, you may actually be right. There's a record called The Soul of Italy by Richard Tucker singing Neapolitan songs. There's a very good chance that I somehow got my hands on that record and was simply reading the back.
Yes, I'd like to think that's what probably happened. I was under the impression Richard Tucker was just a name on a piece of paper.
Oh, he's very much living and breathing. Here's what I said. A simple of Tucker. A sample of Tucker. Bongos and strummed Parisian guitars. Xylophone. A beautiful Euro vocal from Zaz. Sweet rhythms, hand claps and funky times. Amina is there. There is lots of talk of Naples and B is rapping about Italy. It gets real groovy.
Man that invented breathing, Richard Tucker.
Is that one? That's one of the lyrics, possibly. Possibly misheard.
I like it. 5 minutes and 8 seconds as well, which is a long CW song.
What a long CW song.
Exactly. This is what you would call a hidden gem, I would say. It's not making anybody's top 10 Cockney Watchdog song list, but it is not.
Number 7 in mine.
This is not Japanese talking 7.
No, but it's fun. It's a nice, gentle song, and it's straight up Cockney Watchdogs song. You know, like I said, there's not many straight up new Cockney Watchdogs gems, but that's one of them. We're not next up is not yeah. not one. We're back to the rookies, back to the Digimon songs. Rookies to Champions. This one's called. Let's see how it holds up to the earlier Cockneys evolving to rookies. I also believe you said this would be a short one, and we are five songs in.
Yeah, I just thought.
Rookies to Champions.
SMART.
Nina digivolved to Mina. Anna digivolved to Anna.
Delightful, gentle sing along. Are we sure this isn't just the same song from CW2 as Rookies to whatever it was called? I'm going to listen to Champions to Rookies. Is it just the same song?
I think we are quite stupid.
Oh, okay.
To rookies.
Now that's not the same song. So, is there a song called We're Quite Stupid?
There was
I'm,
one.
I'm with stupid.
I'm going down, smalling.
No. I think
there's definitely one on this album that we looked at.
Yeah.
This is We're Quite. Play that one again.
Champions to rookies.
So the sample's there, but this is a very different song, and this is one's far best, far better.
Yeah, I like this one.
Yeah,
far best. I like this one. It's sweet, but
no buts.
No further questions. I did say this was probably one of the better ones if you could tell what the words were.
So you were saying that you dominated or took over this album, which may be the case, but there's a bunch of songs where I just dominate. This is just basically one of my songs with you trying to keep up. It's like I'll sing like one of my normal songs, like This Madness, like Poppy Jingly Jangly, and then I just look at you and you have to sing the next line in the 5 seconds that I've given you. But yes, it works well. You did a good job.
I think it prepared me for a later life and came in handy for the poetry degree that I got and used so frequently.
Prepared me for the Navy.
It did. I also say something very, very much a lie at the end, which is come back for parts 3 and 4, which are like something like ultimates to megas and megas to super megas or something like that. And that never returned.
Okay, never returned, but
there is CW8. You never know.
Never know. A gentle poppy strum with the We Are Quite Clever sample. Pop Watchdogs, I say. My teeth are crumbling and I talk like Chinese writing and my old friends don't understand me. Great stuff. We Are Quite Clever.
Other than saying Chinese instead of Japanese, it sounds quite self-referential to what is going on with young Nathan.
Very, very good. Were your teeth crumbling?
Could have been. I was a child.
Yeah, they were falling out.
Getting my new teeth in.
Could be. How old have you been? You've been 10 at this point.
Yes.
Somewhat out of the realm for the milk teeth, but you know, who knows?
Or possibly 9, depending on the time of year.
March, it would have been, you'd still been 9, yeah. We are quite clever for making this song, I've said. Lots of hand claps. I am so smart, MSRT, Futurama reference. Digiball to Nathan. Clapping at the end and a whisper. Let me just say it one more time, the end.
I like that there was just a gag at the end where I set up that it's going to cut off the song before I say the line with the delivery of me saying, let me just say it one more time, tells you that I'm not going to be saying it one more time. And then it cuts off mid-line, which is quite Maudy.
Very Maudy. What I would
that is
say.
All I'd say about that one. I think we move away from Digimon after this permanently.
We may not come back to Digimon, unfortunately, but what I do like is that the old tropes that were a big part of CW1 have now become kind of just in we don't even think about them. So clapping and just whispering, they're just kind of all in the mix now. It's a mature Watchdog sound. Don't forget, this is our fourth album. Plus, we did
this is
no Rodeo
number one.
No, if you count this O'Leary's album, it's our fifth album.
And I do.
This one, unfortunately, doesn't use the whole word, and it is called More Talking.
It's not what I called it. I'm just going to say that now.
I'm going to change it now because I do believe you did use the whole name and called it More Japanese Talking. However, let's have a listen and see if that's exactly what it is. Awata means end, which is also a joke because it's right at the beginning. Or finished.
I can speak English!
Run too fast. Spoilers. The Earthlings call them spoilers. So, what do you to say for More Japanese Talking?
The only note I made was a link that I've sent you.
Hello.
Specifically the last 30 seconds of the link.
These two Japanese schoolgirls have...
Unacceptable.
Put it on.
Jeez. Yes, but they had no excuse. The little British people had... They were not
what
children.
What year that was? Do you know what year that came
2005
out?
2005 or something like that.
This one? This is like 2012.
Oh, Jesus. That's...
But the voice Matt Lucas does at the end reminded me very much of...
And the bit at the end where you say I can speak English reminded me of the Phoenix Nights where he's talking. I don't know who he's talking to, but he's shouting the words in English, very like just individual words, as if that would help the foreign man to understand.
That's this very is all... Peter King.
Big light.
This is Anna's most dramatic performance, I would say.
Yeah.
And I think probably her most comedic performance. I think that's her shouting I can speak English.
Okay.
Bit of a cold. Obviously, the big twist at the end of the story is that she could speak English. And then the end English performance, play, if you play the last, 15 seconds again, it kind of reminds me of Troy McClure giving, an over-the-top.
I speak English! I'm English, man! English!
Is that her? I'm there, listen, you can hear me.
English!
I think with them, definitely me just listening to your nonsense of More Japanese Talking. That would
be considerably worse if Mina was there.
No, it'd be considerably better because she'd be giving you the nod to say it's okay. The Japanese understand what you're doing and we appreciate it.
Yes, of course. It is you at the end, the laugh, but it's funny that the laugh sounds like my laugh now. So I thought it was me at first. And I thought that can't possibly be the case because I would have to have travelled back in time.
I didn't even know we had a butler. Didn't he? You know, he fell over there with a comic on a tray.
I know, he seems to be, he's trying to edge his way into all of our other works.
Unbelievable. No, thank you. This does not require any characters. We've already got enough here ourselves, such as Nathan, who discovers the word shite in Japanese, which means to do.
Yes. I think it's Anna once again.
Pronouncing it as shite and finding it hilarious.
Yeah, I do remember saying shiter and finding it very funny.
Yeah, because she's allowed to. She wasn't allowed to swear as we were in the O'Leary house. It was encouraged in the O'Leary house. Effin and Jeffin was a way of life.
Exactly.
Nathan does the voice, very convincing, and he does an Indian man voice as well, and he does some whispering, and then there's a I can speak English shouted several times towards the end.
I didn't spot the Indian, but I'm not surprised. I think it was just, again, Azaria just opened up a world that allowed young white children like me to feel like this was okay. And
was
maybe
all Azaria's fault, that's right.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm doubling down on. I've missed the whispering. This is the first time, this and possibly one earlier. are the only times I've noticed whispering so far, which means that we probably put in slightly, maybe 30 to 40 seconds more prep time.
I think this is wild and winging, and I think we're just better at the whispering. So maybe there's hand signals as well at this point.
Maybe. The whispering at this point seems to be between me and Anna more as opposed to me and you, which it used to be. Which, oh, yeah, leads me to think we maybe planned slightly more.
Well, the next album, as we know, is a Brendan Free album that remained unreleased for many, many years. That's going to be fun when we get to CW5, the Lost Tape.
Second to next. Next one's
CW4, an early renowned event, which is a great record.
Yeah, that's a real powerhouse. I feel like there's time between those two as well.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That one, CW4 was done after I came back from Japan, so there's more than a year.
Yeah, 1, 2, and 3 clearly have the same sort of time frame and ideas thrown about, and the same lyrics more often than not. And 4 feels like it is a departure from that and a step towards new CWs, despite a 10-year break after it.
Yeah, this is very much the end of an era in many ways. The first 5 Cockney Watchdogs albums, if you want to count it that way. But speaking of songs that we repeatedly came back to, Secret Hidden Song, the sequel. This is the 3rd or potentially 4th version of the Secret Hidden Song. Let's have a listen.
This treasure is definitely hidden.
Beep, beep.
Beep, beep.
I bet the French hid it. Oh, Vikings.
Our soldiers working for a third world government. Okay.
I bet the French hid it, or Vikings, or soldiers working for a third world government.
Well, there's another version of this song later. And the way that line, I'll come back to it, but the way that line is delivered is one of the best CW line deliveries in any of these early albums, I would say.
Okay, well, we'll get to that.
We will get to it. Yeah, not a sequel. It's like number 4.
A fourquel.
I like the brashness of, we no longer hide the Secret Hidden Song either. It just comes like 6th on the album. And I believe there's a very last second cameo from Nana in the last like second.
Ah, yes, we'll get to that one. I believe the Secret Hidden Song on CW2 was not very well hidden either. It was track 23 and 24 out of 28, but that was part of
that was alphabetical blame though, whereas this one is not alphabetical yet. It is still number 6, and there are 2, and neither of them are the last song.
But you're assuming that because it's not alphabetical, there was more thought put into it. It may be that these are completely random selection of
order. Yeah, I prefer that in a way. I prefer it. But yeah, the last like 3 seconds of that song has my name being shouted. There it is.
If only we could ramp up the volume, we'd be able to get. It's not quite what's actually banging, lads, but it's nice.
Once again, I thought it was in real time. Which confuses me.
Here's Mr. Joanne's.
It's not the best secret. It's not even the best Secret Hidden Song on this album.
No, but it's a nice acoustic break in between yet more Japanese talking. This one
My last point is it does fit the thing of having 2 versions of the same song, which has been frequent on the last 2 albums, or it's just sort of a repeated version of the same song, but without instruments or with more instruments.
This is kind of why I said it reminded me, I was kind of joking, but Igor by Tyler, the Creator, because I've listened to that album like 7 or 8 times and I can't grasp what's going on. Like, there doesn't seem to be any songs on it. Like, they're not like real songs, and they're kind of very slippery. And that's what I got from this. It's kind of a lot of slippery little numbers. It's not like some of the early ones was like song, 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 song. This is just like made up entirely of detours. Like,
yeah.
The Japanese
detours and revisits.
Yeah, exactly. Nathan's.
We did make a point early on. I don't think we do it as much. We definitely do it in this one. Maybe it's the Anna one, but of saying the song title at the start. We still do it on this album, but we don't do it for every song like we pretty much used to.
Oh, we like I said, it's a mature Cockney Watchdogs. We chose the right time and the right place.
Yes.
You were approaching double figures at this point.
Yes.
That means Nathan's 5 days in Tokyo.
He does, actually.
I'm gonna have to cross my heart.
Who's coming, Nathan?
It's amazing how much of an influence not the Beatles had, but Yoko Ono had on the Cockney Watchdogs. We do have a song later that we claim that we are the new Beatles, but we are clearly the new Yoko Ono.
Yeah, it seems like, well, Anna's bringing a very Yoko Ono thing to this situation in this song, in that we've sort of ironically and unintentionally parodied a specific Japanese artist without meaning to. But in that way, it does sort of tie it into, like, well, you could say it's racist, and then we could just point you to that Yoko Ono video and say, how is it? It's not like we've just started making stuff up. There's a frame of reference for what we're doing, even exactly. Though there was not.
Oh, yeah.
What are you Japanese kids doing? Get out of my house!
Now we are safe.
Now we are safe. I thought I was saying typhoo, like the tea. My only other point about this is one of the two of us, me or Anna, has clearly learned a portion of Tubular Bells. And is
I've got a feeling it's me playing. It's got my style of that. I think I'm playing something that approximates a Japanese kind of style or a Chinese kind of style of music. It also sounds like Axel F being played badly.
It does. I will disagree because I sort of vaguely have a memory of, I think, Anna learning that and just replaying that, because it sort of starts as Tubular Bells, and then it turns into that sort of morning breakfast song that they teach, basically like the one that they teach you when you start learning to play keyboard or piano.
When you say Tubular Bells, you mean the theme tune from The Exorcist, not Axel F. Dun, 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 dun. You mean,
yeah, just play the start bit again. Yeah, but that entire thing is like 40 minutes long, isn't it? That Tubular Bells.
That means Nathan's 5 days in Tokyo.
Right.
I'm gonna have to cross my heart. Oh, yeah. Who's coming, Nathan? Those are my t-shirts. Oh, your food will be sassy. It does sound a lot like if you play Yoko Ono over the top of Tubular Bells, so mission accomplished.
Yeah. As a 9-year-old, and I believe Anna was a year younger, so an 8-year-old, that must have been what we were collaborating towards.
An angry farmer kicks them out. It's bad enough having English kids here. It's all very much above board.
It is, and at least we were children, that's all I'll say.
Oh, yeah, and good. So that's not the end of the Japanese talking, but
No.
But next up we have an introduction. conveniently enough.
Yeah. It's very it's quite Lynchian.
It's gonna be good. So is that an introduction? There's 2 minutes of menacing sense before we start.
Once again, Joe gets a mention as being a member, and I believe he just simply walked past in the background of a song in Cockney Watchdogs 1 and said hello, Nathan.
It was Slim Pickens at the time. We haven't mentioned that the core band for CW3 is still Hannah, Nathan, Brendan, with guest appearances from Mina.
Yeah, this is also as well, this is Hannah's last full album, other than the one that me and her did that is Euless. This is technically her last CW album for now.
I count the Euless one, the Meless one, as an official CW album. So, but yes, this is the last one where all of us are together.
Yes, which is again end of an era with the CWs, but only to be welcoming in an even newer era.
Oh yes,
that's basically it. You'll be hearing this demo like at least 4 more times in different songs, not even like a sequel to this song.
No, just utilized well as a new part of the CW sound. What I did like is that even though it seems to be, like I said, somewhat random, it doesn't seem to appear on CW2, but it appears many times on CW3.
Yeah, even though they are similar times. Perhaps it does. I feel like I might be wrong because I thought it was from Buzz Fight Story, but then the bit that I thought it was from in Buzz Fight Story happened in a song later on this album, so I was incorrect. So I thought it had been used. For me, that says this is a new feature, but it can't be because I know we've used the sample element of it before. But again, these could have been like the first 5 songs we recorded for 2 and 3, and then they've just ended up here in album 3.
I remember at some point in some notebook trying to work out which was 2 and which was 3 because they're on different sides of the tape. When they get digitized, they kind of got mixed up. Some sweet layers of Casio.
Probably have a go at ordering it, but it would just be sort of using logistics as opposed to memory.
Maybe. Space Monkey's callback over some sweet chord changes. Anna is still recovering from, there's a sing-along, and the first mention, I think, of her being clawed on the face in this, which is the line from that poem, that nonsense poem that's popped up a few times already, but it's the first one on this album. That's another staple. What was that poem? And caught Anna by the face.
I can't remember what it was called, but yeah, it's sort of Frog and the Elephant or some shit like that.
There's a loose improvised feel. Okay. Zaz is in control, I have written. Familiar demo tunes wrestle with Casio beats and xylophones. And a plea from Nathan. Come on, keep listening. It's going to be great. Intro to the previous LP, which is named as Name Unknown. Brilliant. Now that's some proper confusion. Listen to the CW2, Name Unknown. Now this is CW3, which is all actually called Name Unknown. Nathan and Brendan, big hellos.
Yeah, it's very confusion and very delayed. So top of heart. Again, we've not really reached a song yet that has anything to say from a CW point of view, in the sense of like Alanis Morissette, except for where we had, there's not really been a concept. We get a few later on that are quite, there's some powerhouses on this album that stick out way above the rest. But for now, there's not really been anything where it's been like, oh, let's do a song about such a thing. It's just been rehashes.
A good leg song.
And just sort of introductions and saying Japanese words.
I kind of like that. It kind of feels like an end of an era kind of wrap up. It's kind of like when Led Zeppelin split up, they released an album called Coda, which was basically all their outtakes.
Yeah, that's it seems like these are the ones that didn't make it onto album two, as opposed to it being, like choices. Like these are the ones that feel like got bumped to album three.
This is our Amnesiac versus the Kid A of Amino Acids, Return of the King.
Precisely.
So we then go on to a song which I do like a lot, especially the title, which I definitely got from some kind of rock biography, which is called Strobes Going, Violins Going, People Burning in the Audience, which I thought was
Yes.
a which is a great title, but I definitely stole it from somewhere.
What a great title. Yeah, another.
How's it going?
Mina's in it, yeah.
Strobes going, people burning in the audience.
Rainbows going, strobes going, people burning in the audience.
This is one of the
Going,
better ones.
strobes going.
どうも。
So it reminds me very much of some modern classical music, which doesn't say a lot for modern classical music, considering that it is simply several demos that once again played over the top of each other with some screaming.
It's just that popular. It's that popular classical music. Like I know it was using. I've got it
Oh,
from a
that! Oh, that
recent
one!
mod.
Dun, 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 dun. Oh no!
No,
That's not it.
that's the demo. So it's the demo from the keyboard played over. I can't remember his. Yeah, when. We encountered it recently when in the modcast when Sherry and Terry were doing the knife throwing. It's the same. It's that. That's good. That's the one I specifically used for the mountains.
Pithopraktha by Ioannis
Yeah.
Xenakis, the Greek avant-garde composer. Was that also on your mind when you were making this album?
That was forefront of our mind when we were making this. It was not, but it was actually the one I used when we did the Xenakis Mountains, and I put all the Xenakis music over that episode of the modcast.
Yeah.
It's
Ian.
that.
People burning in the audience.
Yeah, it's good. A lot of screaming. So it's
Yes.
a we do like the Cockney horror song, right? That kind of idea where it's got a concept.
Yeah, and there's a bit of a there is quite a violent album in ways. There's not that much other than Buzz Fight Story. I can't think of much violence that's happened before this album. Whereas this, we're talking about there's been a lot of anger. You mentioned the anger early on from me,
There's
and there was the.
darkness, there's anger. I'm feeling that a pre-teen Zaz is starting to ramp up his attitude.
Yeah, he's about to not sing. You're one album away from him not singing, I
I
think.
don't remember when that change happened, yeah.
I think it carries on for four because between four, we must have done four when I was like 11 or 12, and then we did five when I was like 18.
It was a
So,
hiatus. We were working on it for a long time, though.
yes, the idea was always there. This is, I don't know, it's somehow despite being stock classical music in that same demo tape, it still has some kind of uniqueness to it. It's a good one. I think we've utilized the trope well in this one. And once again, a Mina camp. There's way more. I knew Mina did super good, super quiet, and then I thought she did the secret hidden song as well, but I don't think she did. I don't remember either of these, which is nice. I don't remember this until I listened to it yesterday. I didn't remember it being in this or the prior one. It's nice.
What a long blurg.
Oh, no, that's the next one. Circus music fizzing out with Mina reading the title of that demo song again. Ow, I'm burning, states Zaz, as a melodica comes in, hand claps. It gets grim with lots of screaming and shouts of burning. Brilliant. But next up, we have
the most horrific sort of concept we've looked at so far. And I can only imagine it came. I imagine a lot of these things came from a quote on a record cover, on the back of a record. That's where I think a lot of or just sort of like music books.
Oh, there's a couple that we're just reading straight up, like the other one that's called Chicago something, and we're just reading from the liner notes of
all 48 songs of Robert Johnson.
Yeah, that's just the liner notes of the best of Robert Johnson. I definitely took this directly, but I couldn't find what it was referring to. But anyway,
I'll see if Groggly Poncho's cousin Cockney Poncho can find anything and add it later.
Yes, please.
A character just created.
Cockney Poncho.
Alta gave a no, I am Cockney Poncho, and no mito, I didn't find nothing.
But next up is Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. Well, there's no altogether now. It's this one at all, is there, unfortunately?
No, we've seemed to actually have moved away, other than Richard Tucker being said in a Cockney voice. I think we've pretty much moved away from the actual Cockney element of the Cockney Watchdogs at this point as well.
We've abandoned that.
Which just means we're finding our own identity more than anything, is what I can say about this one.
That's what I actually thought that about this one. I was saying, like, you know, the early ones, it was just all Mr. Men and Simpsons, and then little by little we got some samples in there, and it was kind of like this. Although some of the last ones were nice because they had bongos and acoustic guitar, this does feel, as sloppy as it is, does feel like the identity of the CWs is all over it. It's definitely a very CW album.
Yeah, I think this one I was allowed more, maybe not allowed more, but maybe I just brought more ideas to the table of things I wanted to do, such as the Japanese talking and like other things that were just allowed. As we're on album three, why not?
Or five.
Bring in your own ideas, etc. Whereas I think the last one, it was pretty much an idea that you came up with and then we worked on together.
That's worked on. Bold
workshopped.
Claim.
Workshopped as a team.
We went on a writing camp. We took a sabbatical together to work on Supercalifragilistic Song.
And then
the Supercalifragilistic Song.
Five weeks of being in a hotel, Anna snapped her fingers and said, "More Japanese talking."
Truth.
Nonsense, Jumbo! When Sweetman first began teasing me, he went to war. And I did more in that because you are mine.
It actually sounds really nice. The lyrics, I believe you've already used on a previous song.
Three or four times those lyrics appeared on CW2. We did it's like a thoroughly fancy jumble, and then there's a different version of it, and then there's the version where it's the actual real lyrics of it.
Jumble.
Of course, right.
My only point about this was it sounds odd without Fly Through the Night on Silver Wing.
Well, I mean, that's a classic, right?
Yeah, it sounds more like this is the same song, but like pared down, which I've mentioned we've done before. But yeah, this is like the fourth or fifth use of these same lyrics.
Short one, you say? Yeah, so what is this? This one is, because there's a few that later we get to the latest innovations that use a bunch of times. And is this is just you reading off the titles of old songs. It's not the Claude Anna by the Face poem, is it?
I think so. Did I say?
No, this is just you reading out all the old song titles. Okay.
She always gets clawed by the face, no matter what. Again, just violent.
No one else gets clawed by the face, just her.
It seems like a double down on bringing that back for every version of it, which is a shame.
Further reference to face clawing, I said in many, many references to CW1 songs. What's the one on there that does this? I don't know. There's a... All right, so we followed up with a song called Tales of Brave Cockney Seas.
Did you... I have a question about this in a second.
Yeah, yeah.
Feel free to play it first. Did you name this or did I name this? Because
I mean, there's a Cream song called Tales of Brave Ulysses, so yeah, yes. I definitely named it.
However, that song is used in Buffy.
Right.
So I know this song from Buffy like fairly well, but it feels too early. I feel like I'm 2 or 3 years early on the Buffy thing.
But you're not naming it, no. I'm naming it, and I think it wasn't the Cream, it was the Rotary Connection. I think, I don't know if it's a cover of the Cream song. Yeah, it's the Rotary Connection.
It's not a cover of anything, is it? It's just instrumental.
Oh, ours isn't, but the Tales of Brave Ulysses, the Cream song, was then covered by Rotary Connection. I think I just like the title. I really don't think it has any connection whatsoever with the Rotary Connection.
Yeah, no, it's just, it's strange that the Cockney Seas as well sounds very much me.
Oh, yeah. Let's not play too much of it in case people think it's better than our song, which goes like this. Very nice. Is that our first kind of foray into just experimental instrumental music?
I would say so, yeah. I think there's been a few instrumental songs prior to this, but they've been way more narratively structured. This is our first. Let's just tape Nathan on the keyboard for 50 seconds song, I would say, without any additional words or sort of context. There's no context for this song at all, which I like. The title is contextless. It seems like it's just been plucked at random. It really does feel like I picked this title because of Buffy later on, because there's no relation to it being a song whatsoever. But yeah, the timeline just doesn't add up for that. This is our most, on this album, possibly our most experimental number. It's the most in terms of nobody knows what's it for, not even us.
A brief piano improvisation over Casio beats, but it's also got some tape wub. So a couple of these songs, and I'm not sure how intentional it was, but the tape's going wub, wub, wub. And I just assume that this is four track that would, you know, recording on the four track. So it'd be like wobbling in and out, and it stops and then it'll get muffled and then get clean. And there's drum machines in there. It's actually quite a nice track. And you know what? I might even remix this one.
Nice. I feel like something will come. I made the AI album, CW 1, 2, and 3. And
oh, you songs. Did, didn't you? Well, you're definitely going to have to do a couple of specials on those.
Oh, yeah. You should have a re-listen to that. It's very fun. But I think we should utilize... For CW8, I think we should be bringing back some of these themes that we've looked at in CW casts, such as Anna being clawed by the face, etc.
Whispering. Shouting at each other at the start, mum coming in at the end, bongos.
Yeah, we should sort of just do what Eminem's doing currently, which is the Eminem verse Slim Shady thing. We should try and maybe utilize that for CW8, like we take shameless, on the old CWs.
Shameless nostalgic fashion.
Yes, exactly that. Look, it's Doctor Strange, Wanda, and John Krasinski.
Let's move on to The Dirty Child, which I think is... one of the standout tracks on the album, possibly.
Possibly, indeed.
Dirty child.
Dirty child.
The dirty child.
Stop this nonsense now, you dirty child.
Dirty child.
Stop this nonsense now, you dirty child.
No! No!
Now that's a rock and roll band that knows how to improvise. Yeah,
there's a teaser as well. That is not the last time that music appears. This is now the fifth time it has appeared on this album.
But this one, and you sing over it,
song 14 or something like that. So it's,
oh yeah,
it's really that. It's the secret member of this album, really.
In many ways,
not so secret. My note, the dirty child.
Some penny whistles. Chanting, an insistent tune that gets the message across. Mina chips in with a line or two. Did she stay there for the whole LP?
I wonder how much of it we recorded, because I imagine Mina was there for maybe a day or two. So that maybe we did like 10, 11 songs in one day, which is why the demo starts getting frequented so much, because we were just out of creative steam.
Yeah, we're never out of creative steam. We just thought that was exactly what that song needed. The dirty child, the dirty child, the dirty child.
It features the nice new classic CW trope at this time of the stamp saying something and then sampling it like higher or lower pitch. Jeff Apple.
Nice.
Yes. Yeah, I like this one. I like this is one of the sort of feels more CW1-ish.
Yes, it's got that penny whistle on that's not on many of them. The bongo whistle kind of thing that was on earlier tracks. Yeah. That was kind of the sample sound, the staple sound.
Just conceptually as well, it kind of fits with like Stupid Dirty Christmas. That sort of idea of like a scruffy kid, like a scruffy Plattridge kid.
A scruffy was.
Releasing an album about his woes.
Releasing the hounds about his woes.
Yes. This next one. This brings us to halfway, actually. This is my favourite of the Secret Hidden songs, other than the very first one, I think.
Indeed. We've got less than a minute left, so we're going to have pick this up instantly.
Yes, we are. All together now, stop.
Well, that was great. The Dirty Child, that was a great song. But now that takes us to Secret Hidden Song, the sequel to... is it, we hadn't had enough secret hidden songs and sequels of. This has got to be the third or fourth or maybe fifth version of the secret hidden song.
I think fifth. Secret hidden song to the sequel. So is that four?
It's very hard to say. Secret hidden song mathematics is one of the hardest things in the world for normal people like us to understand.
Yes, not Terence Howard though.
TH has got it on lockdown. He's finally persuaded Neil deGrasse Tyson that circles are square and the earth is full of marshmallows.
Exactly. Fluffy earth.
Fluffy earth theory.
Yes.
I thought that first bit where we're whispering was actually the secret hidden part song, but I think that was just the very long intro.
I like this one. This is the third world government. Yes, that bit sounds good.
This bit sounds good. It's whispering, there's robot noises, and it makes a strong case for us actually doing the song three or four times, because even though this is the fourth secret hidden song, it really is just the fourth time we played the secret hidden song. For most bands, that wouldn't be four separate songs. That would just be them practicing a song.
Yes. They wouldn't just release, they certainly wouldn't release it as like five separate songs. They'll probably at the very least release it all as one EP.
Yeah.
It's nice to see, or it's interesting, I'll say, to see Dave without H Robo.
We've already bleeped up. Now, is this more of a tribute to Dave, or is Dave actually there, do you think?
I would say he was there.
I hope so.
I would say he was part of things.
When he was still a regular calculator before he became a flesh calculator.
Yes. Yeah, this is nice. It's gentle acoustic. I agree.
We've already bleeped up most of the bleep bleep.
Yes. Was he? I do like this version, though. I think it's nice.
It's beautiful. It's sweet.
That's all I have to say on the matter.
But up next is probably my favourite song on the album, possibly one of definitely my top 10 Cockney Watchdog songs of all time. The new Beatles are the Cockney Watchdogs. Take it away, Dave.
Go.
The Beatles split up. The new Beatles are Cockney Watchdogs.
Cockney Watchdogs.
We don't need Phil Spector to put an orchestra on our songs, cause they're fantastic anyway. And if he did it without telling me, I'd slap him. Ooh, the little midget. The ugly little midget. Keep your hands off the Cockney Watchdogs, cause you don't have no right.
That was even before we knew he was a murderer.
Yes.
Apologies to anyone offended by those terms. But not apologies to Phil Spector, deceased murderer.
Or the Japanese, as we have not offered them an apology yet.
Well, I'm not part of that.
Yeah, I agree. This is probably the biggest single of the album somehow. This is the most releasable single, I would call it. There's also a few references to the Play Different Universes.
Again, many, many years before. A strong contender. I like the beginning where you sing in the line and then you make a mistake where you stop and just carry on, which again is an unusual thing in songs. Normally, when a band makes a mistake, they kind of stop the tape and start again. They don't just keep going with it. But I appreciate that.
I see Tyler, the creator, doing that.
Oh, yeah. But he'd probably do it as a joke, not because he actually made a mistake. A strong contender. When the Beatles get back together, they're going to come look for the Cockney Watchdogs. A threat against Phil Spector, who was later a murderer, and Mobile Jones.
Yes, Mobile Jones. I also made that note. Yes, the references to different universes were Phil Spector. And just saying they live in a different place, they live in a different time.
Yeah, it's very precog, isn't it?
Simpsons predicted Nick Nolte.
They certainly did.
It's thematic. It's one of the only ones on this album that has its own individual theme that isn't linked to like four other songs on the album.
There's not many where it's got a proper message and a proper theme, because something like Richard Tucker, it is its own song, but it doesn't really do it. It doesn't really mean anything, right?
No, and also quite a lot of the original songs have that demo tape music on this album. So they're all sort of linked. As this is actually independent to the rest.
A badly played keyboard, probably by me, almost certainly.
EPK.
Yeah. All right, moving on to swear words 5 days in Tokyo.
Yes.
Oh, good, more Japanese, I said. Let's have a listen to this. Is this the third or the fourth Japanese talking song?
Third, I believe, but not the last.
We are Japanese talking, more Japanese talking. Nathan's 5 days in Tokyo. And then I guess this is Hannah's 5 days in Tokyo. So this is the fourth.
Yes.
That means Hannah's 5 days in Tokyo. What's your clan? Man, no.
Free room. Monday, I like
that's exactly what it sounds like to me. It sounds like a beautiful version of the Cockney Watchdogs version of City Pop.
That would be beautiful. And also ironic, as we would have not known to make that reference at the time.
No.
So it sort of all ties together nicely. It does feel far longer than 3.5 minutes, you're right.
far longer. I can talk English is once again stated.
It's also, we seem to have given up on the book at this point and are just making noises.
Well, I would say you've graduated from the book. You've got everything you needed from that book and you're just riffing on it. Riffing exactly. Slim Tip.
Yeah, yeah.
I can't get enough of this Japanese talking, I added. I hope there's more.
This will probably be it for this. We managed to come back and do a full album together without you and not do any more. There's still more on here, though.
Maybe not.
It depends what you consider. We'll come back to that in a minute.
Anyway.
Yeah, this one has slightly more instruments going on, at least.
Yes. I'm definitely involved in this, even if I'm not particularly racist. Involved. Yeah, well, debatable, but at least I'm in support of the Japanese and their language, let's just say. It's an homage. And if any offense was taken by that nation, I apologize. We'll wipe these from future editions of the Cockney Watchdogs 3.
I believe as children we were simply excited by the prospect of this mysterious language that we had never encountered before.
Brilliant.
From another time and another place.
But that takes us to a song called Time Matter, which is another one that has a little bit of a theme, but also it references another song. Let's just see if you can work out which famous song it's just got a little bit of a slight reference to.
Time matters.
Beautiful. Have the time of your life. Oh, good.
Precisely.
The riff from Crazy Little Thing. Oh, love.
I did notice. I've never noticed it before, though.
Right.
As I've probably not listened to this in a very long time, probably prior to knowing what that song was. So this is my first discovery of this, to my knowledge. And not only was it musically adapted, it was littered with references to the band as well, which isn't usually a thing that happens when you do a sample.
No.
It's a nice idea, though. I think it should be incorporated going forward. If you're going to sample somebody's song, that you should at least reference them 3 or 4 times within the lyric.
I think so. Indeed, I think it's beautiful. And I think, is it time to get wet or is it time to rock to Queen? Zaz suggests a whispered breakdown. He says that we should take the songs down. I know that Freddie's gone, but let's celebrate with rock. Mum shouts. We missed that bit, but Mum shouts at us in the middle and we pause. Or is it time to run naked at the Queen? It's a bit like a Sid Barrett song, I thought. So I'm going to play a bit of the Sid Barrett song and you can tell me. If the Cockney Watchdogs remind you of Sid Barrett at all.
Oh, where are you now? Pussy willow that smiled on this leaf. When I was alone, you promised a stone from your heart.
Beautiful. A bit. Not really.
I see it. It kind of sounds just like Basil and Colin, rather. That might be why. I refer to it as a good public service song, presumably just for the message Time Matters.
Certainly does.
Which is a good message to keep in the back of your mind. I also refer to it as a somewhat sequel to The Stars Are All Out Tonight, but I can't remember why now. Maybe we list some celebrities towards the end.
I don't know if we do, but there's no way for us to ever know. AIDS killed the king of rock. That's the, I remember that. I think I saved that front cover because I was a big Queen fan at the time. Just a few years before this record came out, we lost Freddie. Although by that time it was about...
Before? Oh, yeah, sorry.
Like 10 years.
They meant before Crazy Little Thing called.
No.
Before the Cockney Watchdogs song.
No,
But anyway, it's brilliant. It's a really nice song, and I think what we've done is it interpolated the Queen song and made it like better in almost every way. So well done,
agree.
Us.
And I think Freddie would agree. And I also think that having those two songs together, yes, probably not. But who's asking him? Those two songs together work nicely as a little refresher to remind you that we have some concepts and ideas. Oh no, sorry, oh, yes. I forgot there was the Tokyo song lodged in the middle of them.
Well, his next one, if anything, is all concept, no song.
Yes, all substance, no style.
70-word song. It is called this because there is 35 words in the chorus and 35 words in all the verses. So that's why it's called a 70-word song. Brendan, you would.
Cockney.
Watchdogs.
Cheese.
In space.
Cows.
Pigs, horses.
Glitter.
Robots.
Rabbits.
Horses.
Teeth.
Sad.
Super.
Heroes.
35 words.
That was easy.
Nice little drum sound there at the end. The chorus is 35 words said 35 times.
My first note about this was the line, this is the 70-word song. It is called this because there are 35 words in the chorus.
And also 35 weird. Words in the verse.
Yes, but also then the chorus is repeated.
35 times.
35 to 40 times, yeah. 6.5 minutes long for... this feels more Maudcast-y than a lot of the old CW songs. It's 6.5 minutes long and we are just... It sort of just sounds like an end song. We're just saying, I'm assuming we're just kind of playing that word association game.
Maybe, but all the words are like the standard Cockney Watchdog songs from like early on, like Cheese and Express.
Oh, yes, of course. So it's possible we just read from a piece of paper the names of songs that we had written down. Not bad, though. I feel like there are some niche music fans who would really pick this one apart and get into the whole... You know, the 6.5 minutes of it all and the journey it takes you on and the melody changes and the key changes and the tone changes, presumably.
We should do a set of reaction videos to our best and worst Cockney Watchdog songs.
Yes, just play them to an audience of people. And
play them to someone who can pretend to be surprised.
Yes, and understand. I also quite liked Brendan, if you would.
Very nice. We've very stepped formal. It up a little bit. But next up is Barney Rubble versus Barney Gumble, which I've got a feeling. What's that?
My last point about that one was that towards the end, then it is again very Maudy because I'm clearly playing two characters with the same voice talking to each other.
What are they talking about?
I feel like just then when you played it, I said something like, this is good. No, it isn't. As if it was two people arguing.
Very good. Barney Rubble versus Barney Gumble. We have done one called this before, right?
No, I didn't realise it was this late. I also thought it was like album one.
Yeah, let's...
Maybe we will.
And that is our Wesley Willis tribute, of course, sung in exactly the same style as all of Wesley Willis's songs, but yes, not with the same.
What's the Wesley Willis song I will be familiar with? I'm sure there's one that you've sent me.
Alanis Morissette?
Yeah, that's the one.
Any chance?
That would be the one. I re-listened to some of the AI CW stuff last night.
You are a rock star. You are a rock legend to the max. You can really knock it out. You can really whoop a horse's ass.
Beautiful. Rest in peace, Wesley Willis.
Indeed. Yeah, I like this one. This is also quite singly. It's also the first, somehow, again, album three, album five, technically, the first direct Simpsons reference, I think. There's been a couple of, you know, like lines or references to characters, but this is the first flat out Simpsons usage or Simpsons song, and it comes this late in the day.
I think so.
Which surprised me. And then, I made the note, the episode seems to be playing When Flanders Failed, which is a beautiful moment of serendipity. And then I realised that, no, it isn't. It is playing the episode where Duffman shows up and Bernie's sober.
Yes.
It kind of still works for us because we've looked at it with the Duffman cast and the Larry cast recently.
Oh, yeah. Duffman can't breathe.
Oh, no.
Are you ready to get deaf?
It is strange that those things exist within the same time frame. To me, just because we've looked at it recently, it all sort of feels new, even though we're looking at this now.
What year is this?
yeah, it just feels it's strange that that Duffman episode is so old that it came out at this time, probably like 3 years earlier than this. But in my head, it feels like it could have been about 10 years after this.
It came out in the last century, and we're a quarter of the way through this one.
Indeed.
The songs that came out in the 1990s are closer to the T-Rex than a Brontosaurus was.
Exactly, I saw that. I saw something akin to that last night. Like Cleopatra is close to the word yeet.
That's the word riz.
And well, then the last Cleopatra before her.
Cleopatra 2 is closer to...
no cap.
iPhone 23 than she is to Cleopatra 1.
Yes.
A Wesley Willis tribute. B is dominating, but Zias is holding his own. I do notice in a few of these whether I was maybe wanting to get more songs under my belt, because of course I was writing other songs at the time, but whether I was getting too angsty and wanted to take over. But there was definitely some Zaz in there holding his own. Barney Gumble in the background, are you ready to get duff?
Precisely. It is also quite obvious the concept of this song is that, yeah, you wanted to do a song and I was watching The Simpsons. Is what I think has happened.
Okay, let's do Barney Gumble versus Barney Rubble. Okay. In fact, this wasn't quite the era I had to persuade you yet. I think you were still fully on board at this point. And it was only really around this time of Cockney Watchdogs 5 that
yes.
I had to persuade you, I believe. When you were already in your late teens.
I can tell from the new Beatles song that I was... That didn't sound like it was my choice from the start. The enthusiasm levels at the start sound like I've been told.
They don't match more Japanese talking for.
No, that's what I clearly saved my creative energy for.
But you see, the thing about the CWs is even though we disagreed, we respected each other that we went down that path. There was no tension in the CWs really, other than occasionally when somebody wasn't ready to press the record button. Early days there was, but by this point our tensions had been, you know, we'd solved our problems. We'd realised that we were a strong team.
Yes, I like the one where you scream. That's one of the best ones. I ask, are you ready? And you scream, yes.
But in my defence, we don't know how long nonsense had been going on before that.
True. I feel like the situation was I'd asked you, are you ready, like 6 times.
Or maybe something else. Maybe I just accidentally hit my thumb with a hammer trying to nail it, a nail into a
maybe. Oh, table. You were just super ready.
I was so ready that it came across too strong, but I actually meant it in a kind of like, sure I am.
Yes, and then it's also like a really gentle song. It's like the Take Me to the Mountains.
But to our credit, we could have edited that bit out, but I did not.
Indeed. Black snow.
This is when Zaz is going off.
And the stone comes down and gives him a ride.
My goodness, quite a change of direction there. It sounds like a 12-string guitar I'm playing as well, which you might have done. It's quite jangly. Dark acoustic number, fill the sky with darkness. Paper black, CWs go goth.
Indeed, indeedly doodly do. It's sort of an unintentional prequel to the stuff me and Anna do with the black leeches.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
It sets up that. I like the lyrics of this one quite a lot, which led me to think that they were written by someone else. The word etchings comes up a lot in this song, as if it were. It sounds like it's being used as if a word for a demon or a specific kind of devil, but I can't find anything. But it kind of fits like etchings, lemmings, some kind of like some words that get used in reference to hell that aren't particularly related to hell.
Was this pre-Buffy for you, or were you already like getting into Buffy at this point?
I feel like it's pre-Buffy, but we discussed that the Tales of the Brave Ulysses thing.
Oh yeah,
and me knowing that directly from Buffy, but definitely like not this early. I started watching Buffy in season 6, like towards the very end, and that was on in like 2002.
1997. So yeah, season 6 would have been 2002, 2003, right?
Yes.
2002. So a couple, so not long after this. This is, but a couple of years for sure.
Yeah. So I don't think there's any. There'd be way more references and connections. But it'd be pretty obvious if I was watching Buffy, to be honest, I think. It also sounds like Crazy on You by Heart.
Does it?
It does. I believe.
Just pause while this mouthwash commercial.
Exactly. Anna's mouthful of stupidness.
Part six. Definitely sounds like that intro. Nice acoustic.
Go back to most replayed. I believe that's the bit I'm thinking of.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Some jangly chords. I'll give you that.
That was what it was reminiscent of for me personally.
Beautiful. Great song. Shall we move on to Cockney Nation? Are you ready?
What? An easier one to guess the reference to.
Well, you think so, right?
Ready?
Yes.
Nice, the noisy Nine Inch Nails style Cockney Watchdogs dirge.
Indeed. I say loosely, but it's not really loosely based on Zombie Nation.
Do you think it is?
Yeah, I think that's where it came from. There's something in my brain telling me that Zombie Nation, Cockney Nation, that it happened around this time. I discovered this zombie song and enjoyed the concept of a zombie song and brought it to the CWs. There's the music in it. I believe sounds zombie-ish to me.
Let's have a listen. I'll give you that, especially the repeating of the word zombie rather than the word.
Chorus.
Yeah.
The chorus. I think that's what that noise is trying to do.
What it made me think of with all of the nonsense going on was Chicago footwork. This kind of like madness where there's multiple kind of samples playing at the same time. RP Boo, brilliant.
I've never seen someone look so happy to be doing what they do. He looks thrilled to be there.
RP Boo loves his stuff. That footwork stuff is great because it's just like the same sample played like 500 times with these like different like chaotic beats around it. Brilliant. Very Cockney Watchdogs.
I've also noted that it's a lot more instrumental work on CW3 than I remember on the prior ones, but there tends to be one instrumental song knocking about.
Yeah,
as a concept, but I feel like by CW3 it's more experimental. I feel like I had a hand in it with the Cockney Nation, Zombie Nation thing. And I think comfort has settled, and I am now bringing ideas to the table of my own, such as five Japanese talking songs and this, and the Simpsons shit.
Very nice. A heavy Casio beat, xylophone, angry keys, it's Cockney Nation. Dark times for the CWs. Yes.
Exactly. That... Ladies and gentlemen, the Nine Inch Nails, as they're introduced as that. On a
yes,
surreal every world of of kettle boys.
Yeah, but again, Devil Slave vs Union Jack. Really, this isn't the first time it pops up, is it?
Yes.
Oh my goodness.
It's quite the songs on this album that stand out. Really stand out. The three or four standout songs are, as you say, you would list them in the top 10 of all time. The rest of them all just sort of form this album, I would say.
They showed up.
They collectively work together to form this album, but, you know, you're not going to listen to Anna's Mouthful of Japanese 7 on its own, are you? You need the other six.
I don't know. It might make out a good playlist.
The Devil Slayer was Eric Simon Payne.
He was a billion. Jack in America.
Devil Slayer is finished from the Marvel Universe.
So, like, essentially, those are. There's almost no difference between the lyrics of that song and our sponsors of the podcast.
No, including the fact that they are both sponsors for the podcast.
Yes.
A running theme that continued on to this day. I made sure they were in the same season as well, and they were both so adamant to take each other out that they did such a bad job that they were both sent home. Yeah, this is what you would call a CW classic. A real redeeming moment for this album. It fires on all cylinders. And there's a line, when you say, I think it's me, when Union Jack has no supernatural powers, works really good with the music as it plays. I would like you to play that part.
You know what part that is?
It's early on. It's like the first, like, I'd go from there.
Union Jack has no supernatural powers.
That's probably the best bit of serendipity for this song.
Oh, it's it's the universe synchronicities, isn't it?
Exactly. Synergy. Yeah.
Tells sorry story. Ends with clapping and a fight, does it? Let's have a listen. We haven't had a clapping one in a while.
Yay! A draw!
Neat turtle obscurity. Neat turtle obscurity. Union Jack.
Devil Slayer! Yay! A draw!
I think Union Jack was the best!
No!
Yeah!
Grrrr!
Yeah! Right, ending to a song. Not the far few songs end in a fight.
Some of the weakest roars I've ever heard in my life.
Not growls. We also established that growls were no good earlier.
Yeah, I like to hear what the references are.
Yeah, these are less direct than some of the early references, which were, you know, direct. We didn't play Crazy Little Thing Called Love because I think everyone out there already knows it, right, listeners?
Yeah, exactly.
Next up is a song simply called Ect, not Ect, Ect.
Not et cetera, Ect. There it is again.
There it is. It's a very damaged, it's almost like a remix. Yes.
Yeah. It feels a bit like it feels a bit like it could be the end song. It's got a bit of Cockney Watchdogs, Cockney Nation in it. Got a bit of that demo song in it. It could have worked. Maybe this is the true secret hidden song, and that's why there's just little gaps at the end of it. My only note about this song is it's the same music as the other seven songs that it's played in so far in this album. It's not bad, though. It's definitely... if you asked David Lynch to pick a favourite song from this album, this would probably be his choice.
Whirring and buzzing and flubbing and casino beats.
Yes, I think he would love this in Anna's 5 days in Tokyo.
I think he would. And what? How would he say that? That's marvellous.
Exactly. That was good. That was a good one. You should bring him into the podcast. We'll have him on the Twin Peaks cast.
That's absolutely marvellous.
Just say that all the time. Yes, I like the ones where there's not much to, there isn't really anything we can pick apart. We just have to accept it for what it is.
Just take it for what it is, even though we don't know what it is.
The first 10 seconds that you played it sounded like skipping through the song, but it's not. That's just how it is, which makes me think.
Very damaged. It's very good indeed.
I wonder what I was saying, and my guess is probably that poem about being slashed across the face.
Latest innovations comes up soon as well. But first, yes. We have Anna's mouthful of doofishness. Now, don't get too excited. This is not, as far as I know, another Japanese talking song. It is some sort of strange relation where that song has now evolved into whatever this is.
In Anna's mouth full of stupidness.
That is Jap Blanc, suitably named for this album. That's what that made me think of, an exploration of sound poetry, highly expressive Jap Blanc tribute piece.
Well, maybe this was the thing all along. Maybe it didn't say Anna's more Japanese talking. Maybe it was supposed to be Jape talking.
Jape Blanc.
Yes. It seems like the exciting development is that we did the Japanese book, and that gradually turned into noises being made throughout those songs, and then we continued them with a sequel that were just noises. And this one is probably Anna's most enthusiastic moment since Family.
Oh yeah, if you think this is the end of many logical paths.
And it could potentially as well, given the running order, enter her last song.
Well, within just over a minute, we've managed to have Echt and Anna's Mouthful of Doofishness, both beautiful. And for most people, that would be the highlight of their career. But not for us. Not for us. Up next, two versions of the poem Latest Innovation. But let's have a listen to your first version of it.
The Latest Innovations.
Every appliance that passes is the future for science and technology. We are the people who bring you the latest innovations to help you. We'll give you a simple demonstration. Just step this way. Please don't delay. Think what you'll say. Buy one today. Every appliance that passes a buyer's is the future.
Bring you the latest innovations
to help you. We'll give you a simple demonstration.
Just step this way.
Please don't delay.
Think what you'll say. Buy one today.
Exactly.
Sponsored by every appliance that passes by us.
That was the second version.
Yes.
It is, I believe, from a primary school play. I believe that's what it is. And I believe I enjoyed it so much that I felt the need for us to cover it twice.
I think so.
In searching for it, I cannot find it.
No, I couldn't find it anywhere.
It must just be something that was written. You know, you can probably like purchase school plays off somebody, that kind of thing, like a writing company. But it does, So this is probably the only version of this that exists.
Well, I couldn't find it anywhere.
Yeah.
See, when Andre 3000 releases it, it suddenly becomes on top of the Billboard. But when we do it, see, let me play that a little bit more, that song, and see if you can tell the difference.
We are the people who bring you the latest innovations to help you. We'll give you a simple demonstration.
I tricked you. That was the Andre 3000 album being played underneath my a cappella.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You can see the similarities, definitely.
Very much.
It's, yeah, that's all I can really remember about it, is that, and it's also like four lines. So there must have been something about the music that I enjoyed in the song, but obviously we didn't have access to that music, so we just had to create our own music. So it would be fun to hear what this sounds like in the real world, away from CW influence, but it simply does not exist.
It simply does not exist.
Which means that we have the domain over it, I believe.
Yeah, it's ours now.
Unless this is, I will look into it more and I will get Cockney Poncho to add any,
yes.
All ta gave a na, there's none who and foul.
Add any necessary
straight hand claps. Straight hand claps let you know that there was someone else there, is what I say.
Yes. I'm assuming the hand claps were you.
Maybe.
This, as we are, the first version is just me playing the flute. This second version is the one where you come in and sing all the lyrics. So we've skipped one.
Let's have a listen to the next song, which is Latest Innovations 1. That one, of course, was called Latest Innovations, The Song Flute. This one simply called Latest Innovations.
This is, we've just listened to that one. You skipped one.
Really? What did I skip?
The Song Flute one on song.
Oh, is that? Oh, yeah. So you.
Latest Innovations.
You were pointing that out to me, weren't you, with your hand signals? Yeah, all right, so yeah, I skipped one. So let's go back to the version called Latest Innovations, The Song Flute.
The Song Flute.
So you do say, you do some lyrics. Brilliant.
Nice. Yeah, so, no real frame of reference. A clear frame of reference. No proving it.
No, what is this point? It's a classic.
It is. It's one of the ones that is oft forgotten about because it doesn't have a particularly striking theme and there's no, like, physical comedy or silly character in it. So it gets overlooked a lot, but I'm sure it's beautiful to some.
It feels to me like it could be based on a silly character, like a salesman, a silly, silly salesman who's always trying to sell silly things from Shopping Center R.
It could work on the 30th anniversary edition when we bring all these characters back.
Brilliant. But next up is Super Robotic Good, Super Robotic Quiet. So this isn't a secret hidden song. This is the Super Good, Super Quiet, of which there are also several versions.
The wait.
Super good, super quiet.
Just a cover of our own song, but done as robots. Not specified what robots either. It's not specified that it's homeless robot because he doesn't have Dave. We are meaningless for this one as well.
I repeat,
I refer to Caramel the Bear as it.
Super good.
Not really nice.
Quiet.
No.
It is. What is the pronouns?
I'm not sure. I should double check.
Let's not make assumptions. 678. 678.
Exactly. CW74. What was it? Rock 7 Roll.
Funky beats, sort of Japanesey. It's the same song but in a robot voice with a robot theme lyric. A lot of the same songs and sequels on this record. A lot, I say.
Yeah, it sort of it is wrapping up. It's like the culmination of the first three. So we've just gone back over the ones that it's not even the most popular to us, really. It's just Secret Hidden Song and Super Good, Super Quiet. It would have made more sense if there were even more of them on this. Like, I suppose we'd already done. CW1 had some Kings covers, didn't it?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So we've already touched upon this before, but I like the idea of doing a sequel to a song and then doing another one and another one and then another one. But not having them like 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, just having them all be the sequel.
Yes, yes, indeed.
like when Halloween, the movies cut out like 5 of the sequels in the middle and did a new sequel.
Yeah, we're just going to say, well, we don't really like Halloween 3, 4, 5. We're just going to start our new Halloween after Halloween 2.
Yes, less Rudd, more Lee Curtis.
But Halloween 3 is just about like a robot, like a leprechaun, killer leprechaun robots.
Exactly. Yeah, they were going to do a whole thing where it wasn't just, it was different things for every movie, like American Horror Story. And then people just really liked Mike Myers' portrayal of Frank, so bringing him back.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
The Good Lad Song?
Yes.
Good Lad Song!
Shouting over demos.
Yeah, yeah. Again, there's not much to say. This is I forgot Anna was on this one. I forgot about this one.
Should let that play end?
As if it's not been done. As if it's not been done before for 15 songs.
Should let that play end?
Should let that play end?
As if it's a groundbreaking idea. I've just had 11 songs into using it.
I don't even know what they're referring to. We should let what play at the end?
I think just the demo music.
but you're saying it after that you've done it.
Yeah, then I turn it off. Vetoed, idea vetoed.
CW's gone wild.
It definitely sums up this album. This is the theme of this album, is just sort of chaos, and that's demo music. A lot of screams and noises on this album, more than any other. And they're all sort of confined to one album as well. I wonder if, again, with the 2 and 3 coalition, whether some of these were on 2, and that maybe the Japanese talking ones are on 2 and the nonsense talking were on 3. But I like that they're all together in one block on one album. Keeps it all in one place.
I've not been concerned by the fact that 2 and 3 should be changed. There's a little bit where the ones where they're obvious, like this is tape 2, but actually it makes a lot of sense like this. So
yes, I don't think concern is also not on my roster for this.
No concerns. But the very last song that takes us to the end of CW3 is the word dictation song, not the word song, the word dictation song.
The word dictation song.
That's like the beginning of the Copacabana by Barry Manilow.
It is. She was a showgirl.
Stay out of it.
That's the remix.
Her name was Lola. Her name was Lola.
Brilliant.
Exactly. Her name was Anna. She was a watchdog.
A harsh and fast guitar, Zaz on some straight up vocals about soldiers, but mostly about his spelling test.
Is that what it is? I was trying to work it out. I thought it was a list of things in the fridge.
No, I think because you say decimal at one point and then you say can, which doesn't seem like a very difficult word to spell, but it does sound like you've been given a list of words to practice with the definitions and you're basically going through them.
Well, it's
there's
a good...
There's not enough songs where people are practicing their homework during the, during the lyrics.
Evidently, it probably helped, possibly. Maybe more people should branch out into doing that. Yeah, it's not the strongest ending for an album, but it's also not terrible. It also probably isn't supposed to be the last song, but has there been a goodbye song on this album? Maybe that's why there's like 7 on CW2.
We have not got a song on here that stresses that it is the last song on the album or goodbye.
No, which is very, very possibly the only one, I believe, until recent CW times. I think they definitely all had a theme of us saying goodbye, as all albums do. A song specifically to say bye to the audience at the end of the album.
Yes.
It's a nice idea, is it? It's very much the idea of a child making an album.
Well, I think, yes, this is very much existing in its own universe. But by this point, we've fleshed out that universe a lot via 5 albums of material. And so, you know, there's a lot of richness in there. And this is definitely the Watchdogs hitting their stride. We can just do a 29-track album in which every single song is a banger.
Exactly. Or a cover. At the very least. Yeah, this is very much a, we are going to do what we want, which is unusual. That shows that there may have been restraint on the first two.
Yeah.
Or more likely is that I just started suggesting more stuff at this point, and that's how we ended up with a lot of the stuff on this specific album, such as the Barney Rubble, Barney Gumble.
Well, I think that is the difference between the first... The O'Leary's album, you're doing all of the improvised vocals, but then by the time we get to the Kings, it's mostly me. And then I think over the course of the 3 CW albums, we find that nice balance.
Yeah, I think I started gravitating early on towards characters such as Sweet Man, Cheese in Space, etc. So I would just reference them a lot. But yes, by this album, it seems like I've come up with actual concepts for songs or ideas, like let's do that song we're doing at school. Let's do 5 Japanese. Let's use this book and descend into just making noises.
Well, what else can I say? That's the end of CW3. And then we took a year off while I went. We took a year off while I went off. I went off to Japan before we came back and did CW4. Now, you did. Did you do CW5, The Lost Tape, after CW4, right? Because I came back for a bit and then I went back to Japan. So I think that was when we did CW4 in between, and then after you did the secret hidden tape that we'll get to one sweet day.
Yeah, one day. Yes, I believe the only thing I'm using as a time frame is Kieran Martin from CW4 in
right.
The Chief Puff Wars. So he's a swimming friend, and I believe that Paul is on... There's a song written by Paul on the secret album.
Okay.
So I think that places, yeah, I think that would make 4 before the secret album. Because I feel like I made friends with Paul.
Yeah, that
in,
makes
like,
sense.
In the second year of high school, and I was friends with Kieran from being like 7 or 8.
No, that makes a lot of sense. So yeah, CW3, 1, 2, and 3 were all made in the space of, I think, probably a few months. And so then a year off to recuperate before CW4, an O'Leary non-event. So if you listen to this in real time, I'm afraid you're going to have to wait a few months for that episode. But if you're a binge list these CW episodes, you can jump right on to the next episode.
Yeah, even we don't know what it's going to say yet. but you can find out right now thanks to the magic of time. Time matters.
So, all right, bye.
Goodbye.
I'm going to play a little bit of music to see us out.
Go.
And they flood all the back catalog.
They're a favourite on the album.
Do you have a favourite of the album?
I think I've been very clear that I'm a big fan of the new Beatles or the Cockney Watchdogs. And I have a soft spot for all the Japanese talking ones.
Nice. I'm going to give it to Union Jack, the Devil's Player.
Why is that?
I just think it's the most pleasing to my ears and my mind, even though it is. And it's also one of the closest to modern day Mordcast stuff that you can see a direct theme over, like, despite a 20-year time gap, the ideas and the concepts are still very old eerie-ish.
Oh, very much. Very much. We have changed none. We have learned nought.
Exactly. We will take this piece of writing from somebody else, and thanks to the magic of ourselves or a song bot or art bot, we will make it our own.
So why don't you use Songbot to take the Wikipedia entries from Devil Slayer and Union Jack and just put the song in right now to finish the show?
Sounds good.
As a fictional character appearing in American comic books published by Marvel Comics, Union Jack 3, Joey Chapman, was the working class son of a Manchester dock worker who showed a talent for art. Eric Payne was born in Queenstown, Illinois. He was a member of a demon cult called the Agents of Fortune, who helped him unlock the psionic potential of his brain and gave him a mystically created dimensional cloak. After saying goodbye to his allies, Union Jack went home to recuperate before realizing that the entire operation had been part of a plot by assistant director Gavin to have the director of MI5 resign so that he could take her job. Payne could also reach into the folds of the cloak and draw out an endless supply of weapons from any time or place. He typically used melee weapons such as swords, axes, or maces, but also so removed from it more modern weapons such as automatic rifles, and even futuristic weapons such as a plasma rifle. He told Jack that he would make sure that Union Jack remained a high-profile name, that he would make sure that his career rose to extraordinary...
Goodbye.
Goodbye. Goodbye, 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 goodbye.
Goodbye. Goodbye.